Hi, my name is Itti, and I have nearly 12 years of experience in analytics. I've spent the better part of my analytics journey in banking and financial services and in retail companies. I have helped companies realize value from the analytics journey. I've helped them build analytics from the ground up. Currently, I work at Analyttica Datalab, where I am an AVP in the client solutions team. I help new clients onboard onto our platform, and I also help new clients realize the value of analytics for their companies. What's really changed in the past year has been that there has been a significant change in terms of people are now talking more about going the whole tell me what analytics can do for me. So till now, it was okay for data scientists and everyone to do their R&D, develop models. But now it's come to show me the value, like show me the value of what you do. And that's why today we gave a talk on prescriptive AI, which is primarily that last point of analytics where people try to realize the value of their analytics, right? And you will see that trend all through this year. You will see a lot of companies now who are building AI solutions that can be deployed and that can be used to drive value. And the value can be in terms of revenue saved or more marketing dollars or better efficient use of marketing dollars or more sales dollars. But now the trend is very clearly tell me how can I realize value out of this? Till now, analytics was a good thing to have, and we saw a lot of companies spend a lot of time doing analytics. In fact, if you look at the latest research, everyone is saying that all large to mid-sized companies had these kind of value-driven analytics projects. They were kind of dabbling in it, and they had like 11% penetration till last year, but they are projecting like 35% penetration over the next 2 years. So my talk over here was about prescriptive AI. And what I mean by prescriptive AI is it's that last step in analytics. Now, analytics has traditionally been kind of spread out into these four pieces of, you know, descriptive analytics, diagnostic, predictive, and prescriptive. I was talking about prescriptive AI and making it work for your organizations and what we can do in terms of implementing a prescriptive AI solution. Also, we took one of the use cases that we in Analytica worked on with one of our clients who was a healthcare client, and then we went ahead and deployed that use case, and that's what we talked about. How can you actually deploy a proper use case and show the end result to the business user rather than your analytics group? They're extremely important. Without developers, we wouldn't have all the cool things that we are already experimenting with, right? So they are a very integral part of the journey. But when a developer has developed business acumen also, then he is really a true gem, because now he can really look at the business problem, understand the business problem, and translate it better. And that's what we at Analytica also stress that, which is contextualizing the problem. If you're not unable to contextualize a problem, you could spend a lot of time having very mundane discussions or very long discussions without any fruitful output. I think, honestly, I agree with you. I would love to see many more women. I would love to see many more women take part in this entire piece, because, you know, here's the good thing that data science allows you to do. Data science is the perfect blend of art and science. And I think that as women, we are good at that. We are good at blending art and science, right? And it's a great opportunity for a lot of women to come on board. How can we have more women come in? I think it's just about all of us opening up our minds and understanding that, yes, we can have way more women who can come in and join this journey. You might have to, you know, open up your organizations to have more conversations around work from home, or you might have to have more conversations around flexibility, because at the end of the day, you know, all the women who are a part of the, you know, working ecosystem, they are also taking care of their families, right? Or they have another life. And I think this whole conversation around work-life balance, while it applies equally to men, I think women need to know upfront that they have the options. And apart from that, I think we just need to be more supportive, right? I always find it very surprising when people say that there is an imbalance, but they don't want to talk about it, right? There is an imbalance, but what have we done about it? right? Have we consciously taken a decision to tackle imbalance? And once people do start tackling, and once people do start trusting, I think that's just going to figure itself out. I don't think that we need to do something spectacularly different to have more women in this. Absolutely, when you have more women participation, sure, you will see that. But apart from that, like I said, AI is augmented decision making, right? So if you still have a person who's still reviewing the models, he or she will tell you that there is a bias that's creeping into the model, right? And then you can go ahead and course correct the bias, right? AI learns from you, right? If you have more women around, they will automatically start seeing that, okay, we can work this out, right? But if you have people who've generally been biased, if that kind of comes in, then yes, there will continue to be a problem. But yeah, opening more doors to women will ensure that this bias also gets course corrected. Apart from that, course correcting your model is your job as an ethical data scientist or as an ethical programmer. You have to, right? I mean, there is this entire conversation around fair lending. I would say, why is there no conversation around fair hiring? The day you start doing fair hiring, your problems will get sorted out themselves. It's been good. I'm very happy with, you know, all the kind of questions that are being thrown at. In fact, the talk was very well received, and we had very pointed questions about model development. We had very pointed questions about model deployment. So it was nice to see that people were actually interested in making it happen, rather than, you know, understanding the whole picture. People wanted to understand the nuts and the bolts, and I think that's what I enjoyed from this entire conversation.